So I literally just finished filming my reaction video to our first look at Josh Brolin as Cable, where one of the things I said was it's so weird not to see Cable posing with a gun, his prop of choice, when sure enough, as soon as I finished filming, Ryan Reynolds, about 20 to 30 minutes later, had released such a photo. And you know what? I'm happy to redo this video because it's pretty clear from these two photos now that Ryan Reynolds and his team have this character covered. I mean, it's interesting, especially you contrast it with the Domino discussion from last Monday. We're getting Deadpool 2 Mondays, like Suicide Squad Mondays that we had. But you know, that was a big discussion as to whether or not that was Domino, right? Like they made changes. Was it still the character that a small group of people knew and loved? I mean, these characters, I mean, they're coming to the big time, but you know, they're not as quite as iconic as some of the other comic book characters that have come to the big screen, which you know could be a blessing for Ryan Reynolds and his team because they have a little room to play with them and play with Domino. They are, but they ain't playing with Cable. This is left right off of the comic book page. It's incredibly impressive. Every question I had about the first photo is answered in the second photo. So let's get to it. By the way, Ryan Reynolds, so savvy when it comes to advertising. He was, instrumental in Deadpool's advertising campaign for the first movie. For instance, that, famous billboard really did a fabulous job. And I'm sure he's aware of Suicide Squad Mondays, where they suspiciously would leak set photos from Suicide Squad every Monday for about a month or so. And also they had some concept art come out, first look at characters, and it really whipped everybody into a frenzy. So I think that Ryan Reynolds will be smart to do Deadpool 2 Mondays, and one has to wonder what's in store for next Monday, right? We could get a group shot, or maybe Shyola Kutsuna's mystery character could be revealed. But anyway, really fabulous here. I mean, Stephen Lang, I'm sure, is crying right now. They've got Stephen Lang tears on here. You can do that version of the photo. I don't think Ryan Reynolds is that mean, but sometimes he is. Just ask Tim Miller. But anyway, another person I'm sure is crying right now, tears of joy, is Rob Liefeld, co-creator of this character, because again, they got every single detail right. This is really true to form. By the way, I have to say, I think the first picture, what I liked about it so much was that it had a disarming feel to it, right? Because, well, he's disarmed for one thing, because that was okay. That's why I was okay with him not having a gun, because it had an interactive quality to it. Like the second one, the body shot, gives you a little bit more about the character, which is awesome. We'll talk about that. I love the teddy bear. Love the teddy bear. It's such a Deadpool, touch. And by Deadpool, I mean the movie team, okay? But this first photo makes you feel like you're actually interacting with Cable. Like you actually came across him and he's like telling you to be quiet. And it's Cable's rightful position of dominance. Deadpool's gonna have so much fun with this guy. But I just think it's really, really well done. I think the way I want to describe it is an interactive quality. All right, so let's talk about the details they got right. So the star markings on the eye, the scar. He has lots of scars, I'm sure, both physical and emotional. Again, the jokes, they're just so easy. It's going to be great. What a comedic gift to Ryan Reynolds. And I think Josh Brolin will have fun too. He's already proven that he's having fun with this, Brolin. But those scars are inflicted by the clan Ascani. They're markings. Like Bishop has the M for mutant, but that, Bishop got that. That was put on him, like with the Nazis and the Jewish star during the Holocaust. That was a branding, to make sure people couldn't mutants couldn't hide in the future. Both characters are from the future. Cable, he wears this with pride. That's the markings of the clan Ascani, a group of religious rebel fighters from the 37th century whose job it is to protect the timeline. But they follow the beliefs, I think maybe worship's too strong of a word, but of the X-Men and also the Phoenix Force, because the clan Ascani was started by Rachel Summers, who's, get this, the sister from another mother, but the same father as Cable, Jean Grey's clone, Madeline Pryor. So Rachel Summers is from an alternate timeline, the daughter of Jean and Scott. And then she got stuck in an alternate timeline when she got sent to the future. And then since she was stranded there, she started this cult. She became Mother Ascani, and she prophesied the coming of Dayspring, or Ascani's son, who's basically their messiah. And that's Nathan Summers. That's right. Cable is X-Men Jesus. Something else that Deadpool is going to have a field day with. Now, you can see that he has a metal arm and he has metal creeping up his neck. That's a fabulous effect, by the way. Also, these are practical. This is practical effects. It's going to be, you know, keep the budget down. But I'm impressed with how real it looks. You know, it doesn't look cheap. You know, that's just a sleeve that Josh Brolin can slip on. And then I think the way they've done the makeup work with the neck there is really impressive. So anyway, because everyone's always interested in the Summers Gray gene pool, you know, from Mr. Sinister to Apocalypse, etc., you know, they were, you know, these villains took an interest in their son, Nathan. And also, of course, because he was prophesied to be a real problem for the bad guys in the future. So Apocalypse infected him with the techno-organic virus. And so Rachel came to her parents and, you know, the timeline in question and said, I can save my brother, you know, let's just keep it simple, if you give him to me to take to the future. And she couldn't, so they said, okay, she couldn't save him, but she did train him to use his telekinesis to keep the techno-organic virus from completely consuming him. He's a lot like Cyborg, actually, and we'll see who has the more tragic half-human half-cyborg story. Ray Fisher seems to be doing a really good job so far. I particularly was impressed with him in the latest Comic-Con trailer, so we could have a draw. But anyway, that's one of the reasons that Cable's always in such a bad mood, is because he's multitasking. He's always constantly trying to save his life. He's always trying to keep this techno-organic virus at bay using his telekinesis, the power that he got from his mama. All right, so anyway, that's where some of the other scars come from. You see this scar on his cheek. Some of them are battle scars. Some are scars from the techno-organic virus being pushed back, and then the flesh heals. It's also a little bit like the Borg from Star Trek. But then also you can see he has one light-up eye. Now, I liked the subtlety of it in the first photo, but the second photo shows that flash of light from the comics. And it's interesting because, you know, they aren't as painterly as they are today in the coloring of comics. So, you know, when Rob Liefeld wanted to show that one of Cable's eyes lit up, that's what he did. He put a burst of light. So clearly, this version of Cable can fluctuate, you know, how he has a brightness knob, basically. It's in his mind. So I think it's going to look great. I wonder if he can turn it off for stealth mode. If I were Deadpool, I'd definitely want to know that. Also, the teddy bear makes me think of Hope, which is supposed to be like, you know, it was never really clarified, but another potential version of Jean Grey after Jean Grey was killed off in the comics. But they actually ended up making Hope never realize that potential, or they backed away from having her be another version of Jean Grey. But she was a child that Cable adopted and took into the future, into the timeline to protect. Maybe that'll be one of the plots here. Maybe they're going after Hope. It's a rescue mission for Hope Summers. She took the Summers name as well. But I think the teddy bear is fabulous. He's like, I gotta go find the kid that this belongs to. And of course, he's got all of his weapons, and he usually wears blue, so it's interesting to see him in a more military fatigue look, but it certainly allows for the other stuff to pop. It's very cool. You know who he reminds me a lot of now that I see him in character? Michael Rooker's Yondu. Like very, very similar. And I think that Michael Rooker and James Gunn really knocked it out of the park with Guardians of the Galaxy 2. The second half of that movie, I think, is pretty much perfect. And it had so many feels. So I wonder if maybe Michael Rooker, like in another world, another alternate universe, Michael Rooker could have easily played this role. And as we've seen from Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, played it well. Maybe he'll show up. Maybe they'll do a Mary Poppins reference. They've been kind with sharing. There was a helicarrier, of course, in the first Deadpool. So we'll see. But I think this looks absolutely fabulous. And I'm very, very excited to see. Now I think the next thing is the banter between the two of them. Although, already great jokes from Ryan Reynolds in the tweets. Premium cable, your premium cable provider. Those are a little easy. But as you can see from our discussion already, there's just so much to work with. He'll be able to riff like crazy. So I want to see some interaction. I'm very, very excited. It's rumored they'll have a trailer at New York Comic Con in the beginning of October. So get excited. All right, write your thoughts down below, and you can check out some more videos right now.